even when we don't realize it. So that we're guarding against not just racial slurs, but we're also guarding against this subtle impulse to call Johnny back for a job interview, but not Jamal.
Now, welcome back to News One Now. Here's the issue that I have, again, with how folks have been viewing this particular eulogy. Folks have gotten caught up in the president singing Amazing Grace. They've gotten caught up in, oh my goodness, how he was just so forthright and honest about race. What he just said there, that's a policy issue. That's an income inequality issue. That deals with whether or not you can create wealth. When you see the Pew study of the average white household, $141,000 in wealth, average Hispanic household, $13,700, average African American house, $11,000, 53% of black wealth wiped out due to home foreclosure crisis over the last 7 years. If you have a black, what he is saying there, you have a black sounding name, as a 50% chance, less chance you're gonna get called back for a job. That issue right there speaks to that, but they ain't gonna play that soundbite because they don't want to deal with that issue he just raised.
I completely agree.
But they'll play Amazing Grace all weekend and all this week.
It's a distraction because, again, it's easier to give somebody something positive versus convict them. Johnny getting the call back versus Jamal getting the call back is something that is inherent throughout American culture. It's not just in rural towns in the South. That's throughout American culture. It's very hard to convict somebody and have them tune in for tomorrow's newscast when they get convicted again. It's much easier to forgive, forget, and have those soft messages and discussions.
Gina?
It's a distraction, but we have the power to analyze the message ourselves. And so we know that this is how eulogies are delivered. Well, we don't have to get caught up in that.
As Cornel West said, he said there are black faces having this conversation on TV. Are they speaking truth?
Well, that's a good point.
Right, the black faces, but I'm talking about as a community. We have the power, we have the capacity to analyze this eulogy ourselves, and we don't have to wait for the media to analyze it for us and feed us what they want us to have.
Bishop, I also want us to, again, not get caught. I always talk about how you can get caught up in the hoop, mm-hmm. or you can focus on the thesis.
Yeah.
There are people who, when they preach, they come back and, man, pastor preached. And you say, well, what did he say? Man, I don't know, but he preached.
But it was good.
So you got caught up in the hoop and the shouting.
Yeah.
And again, so I'm not hating on the president's eulogy. I'm not hating on Amazing Grace. What I'm saying in the reaction is, just like when I'm in church, my wife will tell you, if I have a half a page of notes, your sermon was horrible to me. Mm-hmm. That hooping don't matter to me. Mm-hmm. I'm listening to what you said. And it's interesting, the reaction to this eulogy, nearly all of these folks talking on television, none of them actually listened to what he said and then had that conversation. They got caught up in the hoop.
Well, they probably thought it was partisan politics. I think it was the reality where black people live. But the positive energy, forgiveness, at least move the discussion on the flag forward. Think about it this way. What, a decade we've been talking about the flag? A decade has been a problem. So now the pressure comes to take positive action. How can we ride the momentum of God's dream, King's dream, the idea America should be a land of equality and freedom? I think that's at least passing through the minds of folk. I think you're sophisticated enough to see kind of the puppetry behind it. Our challenge, or my challenge as somebody's grassroots leader, is how do I use the positive moment to then advance criminal justice reform, which I want to do.
Right, and that's one of the things that we're going to deal with tomorrow because I want to, again, I listened to what he had to say. So for me, tomorrow on tomorrow's show, my challenge to the president is going to be, will you go to the National Bar Association and give a speech and calling on Congress to actually pass a criminal justice reform bill? Yeah. And so that's tomorrow. But still, on this issue, I think, again, if we get caught up in the pageantry, we get caught up in the rhetoric, and we not keep pushing people to say, okay, the family, I ain't forgiving Dylan Roth. Let's just be clear.
I'm not either.
Okay.
I haven't. The family has. They can do that. I'm still a little pissed off, and so I'm trying to hold some folks accountable, because what I don't want us to do is get so caught up in the hype that we run away from keep pushing and prodding change.
Mm-hmm. And what I think is important to remember, since we are glad that the Confederate flag is being addressed, an assassination had to take place first, and eight innocent people blown away in their church first for this to be readdressed. And I believe in positivity and everything else, but I believe in also black people in particular and policymakers looking at the problem of white supremacy, racism in this country, and its destructive impact on our lives, starting with police brutality, starting with Jamal, and because what the president said, a lot of us know it's not news. It was just shocking for us to hear him actually articulate those things in June of 2015. but this is old stuff. And we keep on, the bodies keep piling up, and there's nothing being done but talk. If the white media allows there to be any talk, if there's no forgiveness, distraction.
Real quick, I got to go to break, real quick.
But we got to start with talking. At least he forced a conversation. That's the thing I commend President Obama
for. No, but remember, he even said, again, I heard what he said. He said, we've had enough talk.
Right.
That's what he said in the eulogy. He said, people keep saying, we need to talk. He said, no, we had enough talk. So for me, it's going to be, how do we keep pushing folks to say no? How do we have policy change? So tomorrow, we're going to deal with that, where specifically, again, in his State of the Union address, the president called on Congress two or three times, you pass this, I'll sign it into law. But he didn't say it about criminal justice reform. And I'm saying, out of this, that needs to be a public speech.
Yes.
It needs to be very clear and precise. And you have the moment to say, Republicans and Democrats, sign this bill, put it on my desk. But I'm going to deal with that tomorrow. We come